Good afternoon, my name is Hai, and today I'm going to be talking to you a little bit about public key cryptography and the math behind how it works. So traditionally, when you want to encrypt a message to stop other people from reading it, you might use a password, and you'd use the same password for both encrypting the message and decrypting the message. This works well, but what happens if you forget the password? What happens if someone else gets access to it? What public key cryptography suggests is instead of using just one single key or password to encrypt the file, you use two. You have one to encrypt it and one to decrypt. You give everyone the key to encrypt the message, such that anyone can send you an encrypted message. But because only you have the private key, only you can decrypt said message. Now, this might seem like magic to you, and at the time when this concept was being thought about, it was as well. How can you have two different keys? How on earth would it work? And how it works is a lot of number theory. So first of all, let's talk a little bit about modular arithmetic. This is all to do with remainders. So for example, 5 has a remainder of 2 after division by 3. That's what that notation means. But notice that addition, subtraction, multiplication, they all work really nicely as well. So when I subtracted 2 from both sides, this statement still holds. 3 has a remainder of 0 after division by 3. Now you might be wondering why we're using congruent sign here. It's because there are loads of other numbers that also have a remainder of 0 after division by 3. All of these numbers can be put in their own little group. They're all congruent to each other. Now the next thing I want to look at is something called Freshman's Dream, which is this idea that if you have x plus y all to the power of a prime number, after division by the prime number, it will give you x to the p plus y to the p. The reason why it's called Freshman's Dream is because normally if you have that bracket and you expand it out, you wouldn't normally get x to the p plus y to the p. That's a rookie error. It's a freshman's error. But here it actually works. So as an example, if you have 1 plus 2 all to the 5, p is a prime number, by the way. That's obviously 3 to the 5, 243. And that gives a remainder of 3 after division by 5. Now, 3 has the same remainder as 33 after division by 5. They're all in the same equivalent group, essentially. And 33 is 1 to the 5 plus 2 to the 5. So that holds in that case. You might be wondering how we prove this. Well, it's all A-level for maths. So imagine you have P choose A, where P is a prime number greater than A. That bit's important. We can write it as so on the right-hand side. But notice that not only is P greater than P minus A and A, but P is also prime. So there are no numbers on the bottom that divide P, aka P divides P choose A. It has a remainder of 0 after division by P. If we were just to expand out the left-hand side of our original thing, x plus y all to the P, we get the following. But notice that all the middle terms are in the form P choose A, P choose 1, P choose 2, etc, etc. So they're all divisible by P. So the remainder after division by P is just the first and the last term. That's how we prove Freshman's Dream. From this, we can then derive Fermat's little theorem, so called to distinguish it from Fermat's big last final theorem. What Fermat's little theorem says is that if you have a positive integer and raise it to the power of a prime number, you'll get the original number back as the remainder after division by p. So as an example, you might have 3 to 5, that's 243. And that's obviously got a remainder of 3 after division by 5. How do we prove this? Well, induction. Again, A-level further maths. So, if you have our base case when a equals 1, that naturally holds. 1 to the p is 1. That has a remainder of 1 after division by p. For our inductive hypothesis, we assume true for a equals k. And for our inductive step, for k plus 1 all to the p, our Freshman's Dream tells us that k plus 1 all to the p gives a remainder of k to the p plus 1 after division by p. Our inductive hypothesis then tells us that k to the p gives a remainder of k after division by p, and that gives us k plus 1. We're done. We've now shown it for k plus 1, and it's true for our base case. Therefore, this statement is true for all positive integers. Okay, enough of that for now. Let's see how this encryption actually works. So imagine we've got a message, which is AB, as an example. We need to somehow convert this into numbers. So I've said, okay, let A be equivalent to 1 and B to 2. First of all, we encrypt it using our public key. So our public key provides us with two numbers. The first number is this encryption constant, and our second number is this common divisor. So to find our encrypted number, we raise our message to the power of 11 and find the remainder after division by 65. That gives us 38. That's our encrypted message. To decrypt it, we do the same thing, but with our private key. Our private key provides us with a decryption constant. So 38 to the power of 35, after being divided by 65, gives us a remainder of 12. And that is our original message. You might be wondering how we actually derive these keys in the first place. Well, a common divisor is found by multiplying two prime numbers together. So here I've done 5 times 13, which gives 65. In reality, these prime numbers would normally be huge. I'm talking hundreds, thousands of digits long. And so even though multiplying them together is relatively straightforward, there's no simple, efficient way of factorizing it. So even though we publish N, 65, to the rest of the world, it's infeasible to calculate P and Q. To figure out our encryption and decryption constants, we figure out the remainder, two numbers that have a remainder of 1 after division by P minus 1, Q minus 1. So here I chose 11 and 35, that's 385, and that gives a remainder of 1 after division by 48. You might be wondering why we use this particular fact, and it's all to do with our aim. Our aim here is to say if we encrypt a message and then we decrypt it, it should lead us back to the original message. Simplifying that out using simple indice rules, we get the following. Now, ED, this is where the rule comes into place. ED is 1 plus a multiple of P minus 1, Q minus 1. So when we've got our message and we encrypt and decrypt it, we get the following, which we can then simplify. Now, thinking back to Fermat's little theorem, if we have a message to the power of a prime number, that gives us our original message after division by that prime number. Note that we can change the left-hand side to be m times m to the p minus 1. If we were then to multiply both left and right-hand side by m to the p minus 1, the right-hand side becomes m to the p. But we already know this has a remainder of m after division by p. They're equivalent, they're in the same equivalence group. Now, you might notice here that we can just keep repeatedly multiplying by m to the p minus 1, and we'd always get a remainder of m after division by p. So in our example of m to the ED, we're just multiplying by m to the p minus 1 a certain number of times. And so that just gives us a remainder of m after division by p. Now, you might have noticed we're using p as our prime number, but we also had another prime number, q, which we could have also used, and it's the same principle again. Now, here you can subtract m from both sides, and you'll notice that our left-hand side is divisible by both p and q, where p and q are distinct prime numbers. So the left-hand side must also be divisible by the product of those two prime numbers. Adding to both sides, we get the following. PQ was our common divisor, and that is how we show that when we encrypt and decrypt a message, the remainder is the same message after division by n. Just to go back to our earlier example, we had our public key, that gave us 11. So our message to the power of 11, and to decrypt it, to the power of 35, gives us a remainder of 12 after division by 65. That's why this works. And this proof was also used by the original creators of this particular algorithm. They used it in their first paper to show how this works. And their algorithm, this particular type of public key cryptography, became known as RSA. And it's still used to this day, most notably in HTTPS. Each time you type in a website, it helps to keep your life just a little bit more secure. Thank you very much for listening. I hope you enjoyed.